صباح الخير. مرة تانية بنرحب بيكم في جامعة النيل، أول جامعة أهلية مصرية بحثية في القرن 21. يمكن إحنا النهاردة بنحتفل مع بعض بأول حدث من نوعه يحصل في الجامعات المصرية، إن الجامعات المصرية تستقبل رائدة فضاء أمريكية. وطبعاً إحنا عارفين برنامج الفضاء الأمريكي من البرامج التكنولوجية المتطورة، وده بيخدم كتير جدا في أهداف جامعة النيل، الجامعة التكنولوجية بحثية في المقام الأول. أنا هتكلم بالعربي في الأول وبعد كده هسويتش للإنجليش. الدكتور طارق خليل هيقدم كلمة الجامعة، وبعدين دكتورة ماري ألان وابر هتقول الكلمة بتاعتها. هيبقى فيه في الآخر أسئلة وأجوبة، Q&A session. هيبقى فيه فولنتيرز، ممكن الفولنتير يقفوا، المجموعة الفولنتيرز اللي هيوزعوا علينا كروت، الكروت موجودين في الآخر ممكن تشوفوهم كلكم حضراتكم، هيوزعوا علينا كروت نكتب الأسئلة هنلمها من حضراتكم وإن شاء الله نجاوب عليها. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning, and we are here pleased to have you with us at Nile University, the first research entrepreneurial university non-for-profit in Egypt. And we have the honor to have Dr. Mary Ellen Weber, the American astronaut with us today to share with us the experience and exploring the space. And we are really very pleased to have you with us today. We'd like to send our special recognition and thanks to the American Embassy in Cairo and all the team working to have this event live to our stage. And we'd like to thank Mr. Mark Wenning for all the support, the culture attaché for the American Embassy, with all the support. Please give him a hand to Mr. Mark. Thank you very much. Also, we'd like to thank Dr. Mary Ellen Weber to have the chance to stay for a couple of hours to share with us the experience. Dr. Mary Ellen, thank you. At the end of the session, there will be a Q&A session. So the teams of volunteers from Nile University, IEEE, student activity, please raise your hands. And the gentlemen will distribute like an index card with you, so please write down your questions and they will collect it back in order to answer the questions at the end of the session. I'd like to have your attention that please make sure that your mobile phone is switched off or silent, okay? And there is a special request again for the photos and the selfies and all these things. So we'd like to make it like in a maybe no photos, I'd like to say that. Okay? Please, I'd like to introduce Dr. Tariq Khalil, President of Nile University, to address the keynote speech for today. Dr. Tariq Khalil, please.
Thank you, Nizar. Good afternoon. It's indeed my privilege and pleasure to welcome you all here to Nile University campus. As you well know, Nile University is the first national independent non-profit university in Egypt in the 21st century, with a mandate to promote innovation and contribute to the development of a technology-driven economy in Egypt and the region. And therefore, there is no more appropriate speaker that can address our constituencies than the speaker that we have with us today. Indeed, I am very happy to introduce our speaker, Dr. Mary Ellen Weber, PhD, MBA. She is the managing director of Stellar Strategies LLC, providing leadership development in strategies for high-stakes operations. She also serves on the NASA Advisory Council Committee on Innovation and Technology, which advises NASA on its technology portfolio and on the board of directors of Stellar Generations Inc., a startup company focused on producing ultra-clean, affordable fuel. She is on the board of directors and is vice president of the Association of Space Explorers, the Professional Association of U.S. Astronauts, and on the advisory board for the Uplift Education, a high-performing charter school system. Dr. Weber is a NASA astronaut for 10 years, and she flew on two shuttle missions. In 2000, she flew aboard the Atlantis on mission STS-101, a critical early construction mission for the International Space Station. She also flew aboard Discovery in 1995 on the mission STS-70, launching a communication satellite and performing groundbreaking biotechnology experiments. In addition to her experience as astronaut, she held key positions in building businesses for space research, in strategic communications, and in programs oversight. She is the recipient of NASA Exceptional Service Medal. Moreover, Dr. Weber was vice president for 9 years at the University of Texas Southwestern Medical Center, a $1.6 billion world-class research center and medical school in Dallas, Texas. Under her leadership, the Office for Government Affairs and Policy nearly doubled state and federal annual appropriations through analytical approaches, key relationships, and strategic communications. Dr. Weber received an MBA from Southern Methodist University in Dallas, a university that I'm very familiar with because I got my PhD in Texas. She received a PhD in physical chemistry from Berkeley and a BS in chemical engineering from Purdue. She has published many scientific papers and holds patents in aviation. One interesting thing also is she is a very active skydiver. She had over 5,000 skydives, 16 medals at the U.S. National Skydiving Championship, and the world record in 2002 for the largest free-fall formation with 300 skydivers. So if you guys want to try that, I think it'll be a nice exercise. She's also an instrument rated pilot with over 600 hours in NASA jet aircraft. I'm very pleased and honored, and please help me welcome Dr. Weber to Egypt and to Nile University.
Salaam alaikum, everybody. You know, as you can imagine, astronauts... As you can imagine, testing 1, 2, 3, testing 1, 2, 3. As you can imagine, astronauts get to do some very great things, some incredibly fun things. We fly jets, we train in simulators, we train underwater, and certainly the best thing that astronauts get to do is that we get to fly in space every once in a while. But for me, one of the best parts about being an astronaut was having the chance to share the experience of space with my friends, my family, and with people all over the world. And I remember very clearly on both of my space flights when our space shuttle had landed on the runway and rolled out, and there I was sitting. And I remember very clearly thinking, I cannot wait to get home and tell my husband and my family and my friends and everybody all about it. And that's why I'm so happy to be here today to have the opportunity to share it with you. I believe that space exploration is extremely important. I believe it is our destiny. I believe it is the future of all humankind. I do believe that one day we will have many space stations. We will have colonies. We will be going to asteroids and to moons and to planets. That's my vision. And think about it. For thousands and thousands of years, people have looked up at the night sky and they tried to imagine what was out there. What were those points of light? And they had no idea. None. And in this tiny blink of time in the history of human beings, we happen to be born. We happen to be here at the very dawn, at the beginning of it all, when we are taking our very first footsteps off this planet. And so today I'm going to share with you my experience of flying in space. But I do want to share with you, and as I look out, I see, you know, certainly younger folks than I am. And I look at you, I'm envious, I'm jealous. Because my days of flying in space are over. And even though I got to orbit the Earth and go to a space station and really have incredible experiences, my days are over. But we are going to be going to other places, to asteroids, maybe back to the moon, and certainly one day, I believe, onto Mars. And so it's the next generation. It's you young folks, young people that are here in the audience. You're going to have opportunities that I never will have. And so I'm jealous. So before I tell you about my experiences, I want to first explain a little bit about how we go into space. This is important to understand because most people think that we go into space by going up very high. Well, if I had a big rocket engine right now and I went straight up in the air 600 kilometers, I would be in space, but only very briefly. I would come right back down to the ground. Gravity would pull me down. So how do we go into space? It's not about going up high. It's with speed. You have to go fast. So think about it. If you throw a ball in a straight line, gravity pulls that ball to the Earth in a curve. You've seen it. Well, it turns out that the size of that curve depends on how fast you've thrown that ball. The faster you throw it, that curve gets larger and larger. So imagine if you could throw that baseball or throw an astronaut or throw a spaceship so fast that the size of that curve as it was falling towards Earth was actually larger than the Earth. It would continue to fall towards the Earth, but it would miss. It would go around and around. That's how we go into space. So how fast do you have to throw this ball or this astronaut or this spaceship? You have to throw it 25 times the speed of sound. 30,000 kilometers an hour. Think about that. Think about that. This is so fast that when we're in space, we go around the world 16 times every single day. 16 sunrises every single day is what we see from space. Just 1.5 hours. So think about if you're sitting in Cairo traffic, how far you can go in 1.5 hours. Well, while you're doing that, the people in the space station are going all the way around the entire world. Now, I say it's important to understand how we go into space because speed is what makes spaceflight so risky. It is a very dangerous and risky thing that we do whenever we send anything into space. And it is because of that need for speed. We need to have powerful engines. We need to have essentially a bomb. We need an explosion to get anything going that fast. So when the crew walks out to the launch pad, they're going and they're sitting on top of a bomb. In fact, even the people that want to rescue us, they're too scared to be close. In fact, they're over 6 miles away. The rescue people are over 6 miles away. And if we have a problem on launch, say one of our engines doesn't work, we still have to take all of this fuel, everything with us, and go into space and get rid of it. Because otherwise, that explosion would be here on the ground, and it would be dangerous for everybody, not just the crew. And so it's very dangerous because of that, the explosives that we need, but it's also dangerous when we want to come home. So imagine, everybody rub your hands together for me. Now rub them faster. Faster. Okay, now rub them together 30,000 kilometers an hour. Okay, you can't quite do that, but feel how warm your hands are. Feel how warm your hands are from just that little bit of friction. Well, if you are going 25 times the speed of sound, where there's no air up in space, and then you hit this air that we breathe, the atmosphere, it's incredible heat that's generated. It's so hot that electrons are stripped from the atoms. We're coming back in a plasma. A plasma is like a neon light bulb where energy takes the electrons away and generates all this light. Well, that's what we come in when we come home. And, you know, I told you we need this speed. It's important to understand that we need every last bit of it. When we want to come home, think about this for a minute. If I want to land on a little tiny runway in Florida, I slow down on the other side of the world, but I only slow down 1%. So how many here have had a professor or a teacher tell them, well, you have to give 100% effort? Well, I'll tell you, if you're trying to go into space, you really do have to give 100%. So I've told you about the need for speed and that it makes it dangerous. Well, just how dangerous is it to go into space? On my first mission, they calculated the chances that all the pieces of equipment that are on the space shuttle, that the odds that they would fail. And they came up with a number. They said, you have 1 in 100 chance of not coming home. Well, in fact, we had about 100 missions, and we lost 2 space shuttles. So really, it was about 1 in 50. So those numbers may not mean very much to you, but think about this. I'm from Dallas, Texas, and I did the calculation. At my home airport, Dallas-Fort Worth Airport, if flying airplanes were as risky as flying into space, there would be 10 crashes every single day at only one airport in the world. So even if we make space travel 10 times safer, 100 times safer, 1,000 times safer, it's still very risky. If you were going to the airport and you were thinking that 1 or 2 airplanes were going to crash there every day, you might not be willing to get on that airplane to go to that business trip or take that vacation. So it's still a very risky thing, and even with the new spacecraft that are being designed, it's still very risky. And so it's important. I was telling you why I thought it was important, that I believe it's the future of human beings to be in space. Well, you have to have really important reasons to take those risks. And that's what I really hope for all of the young people that are in the audience today. As you look to your future, as you think about the things that you want to do, the things you want to be, the career you want to have, I hope that you find something that is so meaningful to you. It's not about making money. Money isn't what gets you happiness. It is believing what you do. So I hope you find something that you believe so much that you will devote your life to it, and maybe even believe in it so much that, in fact, you're willing to risk your life for it. Now, I want to take a minute before I show my film, and I want to talk about what it's like to be in space. So certainly the thing you think about most is the fact that you're floating around. I told you we still have gravity. Gravity is still pulling us towards the Earth, so gravity doesn't go away, but that gravity is just keeping us going around and around the world. Inside your spaceship, there's no gravity pulling you to the floor or to the ceiling. In fact, there is no floor or ceiling once you're in space. That's all just part of your mind. In fact, when you're floating around, I can look at that and I can decide that, hey, that's the floor, and I'm floating upside down above the floor. You decide it. It's mental. There's nothing physical about a floor or a ceiling. The other thing people don't think about is just how annoying it is to not have gravity pulling you to the Earth. So think about something very simple, like, say, if you brushed your teeth this morning. Think about how simple that was. You turned on the water, you got your toothbrush, you got your toothpaste, you took off the cap. Probably took you a minute, maybe two if you're a really good toothbrusher. But think about it in space. Well, you have to float over to the locker. Now you've got your crewmate, they're exercising on the bike right in front of your locker, and you float over them, and you get out these things. Everything comes floating out, not just your toothbrush and toothpaste, but also your notebook and your, you know, whatever, and you're trying to get it all back in there. And now you have the things you need, and so you put your feet in these little foot loops, these little straps on the floor so that you're not floating around anymore. And now the toothpaste is trying to float away, and you grab it, you take the cap off, and then it starts to float away, and then you have a little water fountain right here, and you have a rag, and everything is floating away. And in fact, if you turn your back on anything for even a second, you'll find that it's floated away. And in fact, on both of my flights, pieces of equipment were lost for days, and we were looking for them, hoping that we would not have to confess to the ground that we lost critical pieces of equipment. And in both cases, we were able to find them, and we didn't have to tell the ground, but now you all know about it, so we'll see how that goes. And interestingly, so we're looking, and you know where on on my second flight, you know where it was? It was actually floating above the toilet, of all places. Turns out all the air inside the shuttle actually ended up going across the toilet, and there it was. Who knew? And in fact, astronauts spend hours each day just looking for things that floated away. So when I tell you that floating around without gravity is annoying, maybe you have an idea of that now. And then I talked about brushing teeth. Imagine if you're trying to replace a piece of equipment with 20 bolts and washers and tools and checklists. Everything can become a great mess. Now, the other really cool thing about being in space is, of course, looking at the Earth. And that is one of the best parts about being in space. There's a couple of things, and you'll see it from the video, but there's a few things I would like to share with you. First of all, you know, when you look at a globe or you look at a map, your eye immediately goes to borders. You look at countries. You want to look at your city, your country, your... We look at borders when we think of the world. When you see the Earth from space, you cannot see any borders. There are no countries. It's a planet. I mean, we don't think of our Earth as a planet, but it is a planet. And there's this sun, this star just shining on this planet. And you really feel like an Earthling. You don't feel like you're part of any country. You're part of this planet Earth. Now, the other thing that you notice when you look at the Earth is that you cannot see evidence of human beings. When the sun is shining on the Earth, it's very difficult. Everybody says, well, you may have heard, well, you can see the Great Wall of China from space. No, you can't. No, you can't. On my second flight there, we were going over it. We were all crammed around the windows. We were all looking for it. And after we had passed, we said, well, did you see it? No. Well, we'll just tell everybody we saw it. You cannot see the Great Wall from space. But at night, that's when the cities really light up the earth like jewelry. It's breathtaking. It's beautiful. And that's where you see human beings. That's when you can begin. That's when you realize it's home. And the other thing that's really cool, the earth at night, I didn't expect this, but the edge of the atmosphere, it's very thin. This air that we breathe is a very thin layer. And the very edge of it glows just a little bit. The sunlight coming in ionizes those atoms, takes the electrons away, and like that neon light bulb, makes it glow. And you can actually see meteorites going into the atmosphere below you. How many have seen a shooting star before? How many have seen one? Oh, excellent. It's incredible, isn't it? Well, think about this. When you see that, that may be 100 kilometers above you when you see that. Well, when you see them from space, they're actually 600 kilometers below you. They're going into this planet that you are no longer a part of. It's incredible. I remember on my first flight, there were two of us. It was our first flight. And when we were all looking at the Earth, we were all floating around the back windows. And somebody said, "Hey, look, a meteorite." And Kevin, the other new guy, and I both said, "Where?" I'm glad you got that joke. We think of it as up when in fact it's below. Now the other thing I have to share with you, and you will see it in the video, but one of my very favorite, most fond memories of looking at the Earth from space is actually of Egypt. And it's the very one of the first scenes you'll see. And the reason why I remember this so clearly, I had a sleeping bag and we just hook our sleeping bags anywhere inside the spaceship. And I had mine right underneath an overhead window. So there was a window at the top of it. Now I had a cover on the window because remember you're going around the world 16 times a day. And how annoying would that be to try to sleep if it was 45 minutes of light, 45 minutes of dark, 45 minutes of light. So you have a cover so you can sleep. And I woke up. Alarms went off, the music started playing, and I took down this cover, and the view I saw was of Egypt. It was of the Nile and the Nile Delta, and it was breathtaking. I grabbed the video camera right away, and I started filming it. It was before I'd ever come to Egypt. It was before I ever even dreamed of coming here, but it was what made it so beautiful was the dark green against the golden sand, and then you have the beautiful blue water. It just took my breath away. Now, I had talked about cities, and I told you they pop out like jewelry. It turns out there is one city in the whole world, on the whole planet Earth, that looks different from every other city. Can anybody guess what city that is? I think I heard it here, Las Vegas. Isn't that funny? I guess all of those lights make it actually be a different color. And I thought of this the other day. I toured the Great Pyramids over in Giza, and I was thinking about seeing this from space, and now here I was on the ground. And then I thought of something funny. I remember seeing, flying over Las Vegas, and you know, they have one of the casinos there. It's called Luxor, and it's a pyramid, the shape of a pyramid. And at the top of the pyramid is a big spotlight, and you can actually see that spotlight from space. So you. Somebody didn't like that, apparently. I don't know. Sorry. So even though you can't see the Great Pyramid from space, you can see this other Luxor pyramid from space over in Las Vegas. With that, I could continue to tell you about what it's like to be in space, but I think I'll let the video help me out a little bit. And maybe, oh, there we go. Now, the space shuttle, when you think about it, the space shuttle is the white thing, and that's what actually goes around and around the world. But when we launch, we have a few more pieces to it. This big orange thing is actually a fuel tank. It's a little bit like the fuel tank in your car, except it doesn't carry gasoline. It carries liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen. Now, normally, oxygen is something we breathe. It's a gas. It's air. Well, in order for us to use it as a fuel, we have to cool it down so much that it's actually a liquid. Now, that fuel gets burned in three engines that are at the bottom of the space shuttle back here. So when you turn on those engines, that provides a lot of the power. But the real launch happens when these other two things are started. And that's these, we have two solid rockets that are strapped to our big fuel tank. They're called solid rockets because the fuel inside is solid. Once you light it, once you turn that on, there is no going back. You cannot shut off a solid rocket. You just have to wait for all the fuel to be used up. And that, again, getting back to what I said earlier, we're on this, essentially this bomb. If there's any problem, we've got to go get rid of the solid rockets and that liquid hydrogen and oxygen. Now, when we get ready to go out to our spaceship, we get in these survival suits. They have helmets and gloves that will make seals. There's no air in space. If we got a hole in our spaceship and lost our air, we could hopefully inflate these suits and keep us alive long enough to get back to where there is air. Now, the three engines I told you about, you see them turning on there. They light 6 seconds before the actual launch, but the real launch happens when those solid rockets go off. You know you're going someplace, and you're going there very, very quickly. In fact, by the time we clear the launch tower, we're already going 200 kilometers an hour. Think about that. Now, we have seats, but we're actually on our backs. We're lying on the back of our seats. We've got a parachute there. We've got oxygen bottles. We've got a life raft, survival gear. And so it's pretty uncomfortable. There's a lot of shaking and rocking. And at the entire time, what we're focused on is doing our job. So I told you that you have to be prepared to not come home. There's this very good chance you might not come home. But that is not your biggest fear. Your biggest fear is that you might not come home because of something you did or you didn't do. So you're thinking about all the things. You're thinking about your job. You're focused on your job. You're looking at your computer screens. You are doing everything you can, because if something goes wrong, you have only 5 seconds to figure it out and do the right thing. Now, you're in your helmet, all the shaking, all the shuddering, and you have to be laser focused on what's happening. Now, after 2 minutes, those solid rockets, the fuel is all used up, and that's when we get rid of them. And this is where the news stations would often say, well, that was a successful launch. You'll see that those three engines were still running, and they had to keep running for another 6.5 minutes, otherwise we wouldn't get to space. We might just cross the ocean and land over in Morocco or Spain, or we might just go once around and come home. Now, on my flight, all of our engines, both of my flights, they worked great. And one of the first things you do is get rid of that big orange tank, which is what you're looking at there. It's going 99% fast enough. That's not good enough. It burns up, and it's never seen again. Now, what you're looking at here, this is from the back of the space shuttle. So there's a camera back here by the tail of the shuttle, and it's looking forward. These two rectangles that you see here, those are windows. The entire area for the crew to live in is about the size of a large closet. There's an upper deck and a lower deck. And on the upper deck, we have these two back windows, and then there's two windows on the top of it. But it's very small, very, very small, because we want to be able to carry up more important things than just room for astronauts to live in. Now, what you're looking at here, this is a robotic arm. I'm maneuvering it around. That was one of my jobs on my second flight. We were constructing the International Space Station. It was very early in the program. It was only the third flight. Nobody had been there in over a year. So we were in an orbit going 25 times the speed of sound. And one of the first things we did is match our orbit to that space station so that we could connect to it and help build it. So I'm checking out the arm before we do that. Now, as cool as it is to go 25 times the speed of sound, imagine how cool it is to connect with this little tiny dot, which is a space station going 25 times the speed of sound. This is what we call the docking mechanism. That's what I was controlling during this time. You're looking through a camera that's looking up through it, and those wires there help us align our spacecraft with the other spacecraft we're docking to. You see, everybody is on that upper floor of the crew compartment during this. This is a target on the space station as we're coming together ever so gently. Keep in mind, we're both rocketing around the world at 25 times the speed of sound. Now, this next view is from the same camera you saw earlier, but you'll see that you can't even see the crew compartment. It's all blocked by the space station. Now, I told you not having gravity can be annoying. It's also annoying because you have very bad hair days in space. Now, I have my feet in those straps on the floor, and I'm back looking out those windows, and I'm moving that big robotic arm around our space station. I have a crew member attached to the end of that arm, and that's how he's able to get and to the top of the space station in order to attach some of the equipment that we brought up there with them. Now, I didn't do a spacewalk on my second flight, but I was trained as the primary spacewalker for my first flight. If something had broken, then I would have gone outside the space shuttle to go fix it. This is a view from a camera that's on the elbow of the robotic arm, and I'm using it to make sure I don't bang either the arm or my fellow crew member into any of the equipment. Now, you'll see this is a big, heavy piece of equipment that Jeff is moving around there. There's no gravity in space, so you can move big, heavy things. You can actually get them moving very easily. The problem is not getting things to move, it's actually getting them to stop moving. So think about it. If I'm in space and I'm floating around and I want to go over there, all I have to do is just push off and I'll go there. But I've got no friction. I've got nothing to stop me when I reach that other wall. So you can always tell the first time flyers, because they're banging into walls and such, and it takes them a while before they figure out how to move very gently across their spaceship. Now, what you see here, this is at the end of the spacewalk, and Scott is letting our two spacewalkers in through this hatch. That hatch actually led to a few places. If you closed off two other hatches, you would have an airlock that you could do a spacewalk from, or you could keep going through what was a big, long tunnel, and you would get to another room that we had in the back of our space shuttle. This is where we carried up about 3,000 pounds of equipment that we were transferring over to the space station. Now, if you go back down that tunnel, you could actually go through that docking thing, that docking mechanism, and go into the space station itself. And that's what you're looking at here. This is Jeff and Jim were working on some electrical lines right there. Now, there were only two modules or two rooms there at the time. The first, on all sides, had hatches. And the idea was that in the future, we would bring up more rooms, more modules, and that's how we would grow the space station. And in fact, we have many modules up there from many countries. The space station is the size of a soccer field. Back then, there was only two of these compartments, two of these rooms. There were some failing batteries that Susan and Yuri are working on to repair. Jeff there is actually controlling the space station. It's controlled through laptops. Now I want to take you on a going back to the space shuttle to give you a little bit of a tour of what it's like to live on the space shuttle. This is on that upper floor I was telling you about. Again, the whole thing is, you know, just the size of a closet. You get to the lower floor by going through an opening, a hole in the floor. And you'll see that there's a ladder there, which doesn't do you a whole lot of good in space. But on the ground, it's useful to go from one to the other while you're preparing the space shuttle. When you go through that hole, on the left, what you'll see is the door to the bathroom. It's very close. It's right here. And right in front of it is our kitchen, what we called the galley. And the galley was a place, it had an oven, and it also would dispense water. Now that water that we ate and drank, we ate it because the food that we bring up doesn't have water. That water that we ate and drank actually came from fuel cells. We combined hydrogen and oxygen to make electricity, and it also made the water that we ate and drank. Now, here's a great example. No ceiling, no floor, it's all the same, whatever you can hook yourself to. I'll point out that bike doesn't have a seat. Think about it. It only has a belt to keep you from floating away. That's a drop of water, believe it or not. Gravity is what limits the size of raindrops. In space, a drop of water can be as big as you make it. There's one of the sleeping bags I was telling you about. You strap yourself in at night. And now these are some views of the Earth from space. And as I told you, one of my very favorite and very first views is of the Nile. Isn't it breathtaking? And the video it's even far more beautiful from space. Now, one of the cool things about looking at the Earth from space is that you can see the power in the continental plates as they crash into each other. And this is actually the Himalaya Mountains, and where India is actually crashing into China to build those mountains. Sometimes you not only get, here's another view, you not only get mountains forming, but you also get great tragedies, as we know what happened in Nepal and Kathmandu very recently. Now this is two planets rising before the sun, and we wanted to capture this sunrise on film. And it was difficult to do because the light levels change so quickly. But since we had 16 tries every single day, we eventually got it right. Here is the Earth at night, and you'll see some of the cities that I told you about, how they pop out like jewelry. That flashing that you see, that's lightning. Those are storms. And here is this little faint line. That's the edge of the atmosphere glowing just ever so slightly, like a blanket covering the Earth. Now here, this is a picture of the aurora. We live on a big magnet, that is the Earth, and that magnetic field keeps out some of the solar radiation, the radiation from the sun that would kill us otherwise. Only at the two poles of the magnet can that radiation sneak in, and when it does, it ionizes the gas and makes it light up, and that's when we get the light, the aurora lights. Now here, it's time to come home. We set up seats again, and I'm sitting right behind the pilot taking this film, and it's time to slow down just 1%. But we're still going very, very fast. As we enter the atmosphere, you see all that flashing? That's from the energy as we hit the Earth's atmosphere going that fast. Now the shuttle took off like a rocket ship, but it landed like an airplane. It's important to realize it was an airplane without any engines. The crew had one and only one chance to make a successful landing. So think about it. We weren't even slowed down enough to be able to lower our landing gear till just seconds before landing. So that's one of the things, just one example of the things you worry about. If I press that button for the landing gear, will it come down? Will it work? If it didn't, it would not be survivable, and you could not live through that. So after we land, we're getting used to a great many things. Obviously, we're getting used to having gravity again. Everything that was floating around is no longer floating around. So we won't have to look for things, but gravity does make some things heavy and not so good. We're also getting used to being back home. And I remember I started out telling you how my very distinct memories from the end of my two missions, what I remember when I see this view is sitting there thinking, I cannot wait to share it with people. Now, before I take questions, there is something I do want to share with you, because I'm often asked two questions. First, did you always want to be an astronaut? That's probably the number one question. And the second one is, you know, is there any way I can ever be an astronaut? Two questions. And I want to tell you about that, because when I was young, when I was the age of many of the young people that I see out in the audience tonight, you have to understand, I had zero chance of becoming an astronaut. None. No chance. And that was for two reasons. I did not come from a powerful family. I did not come from a wealthy family. I was just a regular little girl in a little town in the middle of our country, in the middle of the United States. And in fact, my father died when I was only 1 year old. And my mom had no career. You see, her two brothers went to university, but at the time, they didn't see any reason why a woman would need to go to university. So there she was. She had virtually no money. She had no career, no way of supporting her three young kids. I was 1 year old. My brother was 2 years old. My other brother was 3 years old. The second reason why I had zero chance of becoming an astronaut is that there were no women astronauts. It was not allowed for women to be astronauts. So if you ask me, did I always want to be an astronaut, I never even considered it. And this is my message to you. Things change. Doors open up. Doors that you don't even know exist will open. For my mother, a door opened up. There was a chance for her to get funding to go to a university. And she was able to, after 7 years, get a teaching certificate. And she was born to be a teacher. She was a wonderful teacher. And she was able to support her three kids. But even more importantly, she was absolutely convinced that education was the future. We still didn't have very much money, but she knew that education was the key to our having a successful and happy life. We were all going to go to university. She didn't know how, but we absolutely were going to. So that's one door that opened. And then also, later when I was in going to college, another door opened up. Suddenly, NASA was allowing women to be astronauts. It wasn't until I was in college. And so suddenly, there was a door open. But had I not been prepared, had I not focused on education, had I not focused on studying, had I not picked the hardest subjects there were to study, had I not studied math, science, and engineering, when that door opened up, I would not have been able to walk through it. So no matter what doors you see that might be closed to you right now, things do change, they will change, doors will open. Your job right now is to be prepared, to make sure that you are prepared to walk through them when they do. Because how tragic would it be if I were in college and I hadn't been studying the right courses and I hadn't worked very hard, and then suddenly I wanted to become an astronaut, and because I hadn't prepared, I wouldn't have been able to. So it is possible. It is possible. How can you become an astronaut? Start now. Start now and prepare. And with that, I think we do have time for some questions. And I think the plan is for somebody to hand me questions that you all have been writing down, if I understand that correctly. If there are
plenty of them.
I love this. How can I increase my chances of being an astronaut other than the luck part? I think that's a very smart question because I tell everybody I am very, very lucky. I've talked to you about being prepared, but there are many people that are prepared. You do have to be lucky. What I would say to you is pick the studies that you do, make sure you enjoy them, make sure you are committed to them, make sure that it's something you want to do, but then also dream very big. Because you might get lucky. You might become an astronaut or whatever this big goal is that you're looking for. It could happen, but make sure that you're doing something that you love along the way for two reasons. Just in case you don't get lucky, but also, if you really love it, you will do well. And it's funny, when you do things really well, you get a lot luckier. Let's see. How did you start your career at NASA? Well, I told you I was lucky. It turns out NASA has an office for astronaut selection. But there I was in graduate school getting my PhD in chemistry. And, you know, it's funny, you never know what can change your life forever. There I was in college, actually, even before graduate school, and I saw this little advertisement in our university newspaper for the skydiving club. And the skydiving club was really just one guy with a car who would drive out to the drop zone on the weekends. And so I took a chance. I thought, well, that sounds fun. I never considered doing that. Had I not done that, my life would be completely different. Because you see, when I went skydiving, it opened my eyes to a whole world that I never knew existed, the world of aviation. I mean, I knew planes flew, but I didn't know what it was like. I had never met a pilot. I didn't know how fantastic it was. So I started skydiving, and I started flying, and I loved it. I loved it as much as I loved the science that I was studying. And that's what made me want to become an astronaut. I was in graduate school when our first great tragedy happened in the United States space program when we lost Challenger. And I was still in graduate school 2 years later when the return to flight happened after Challenger. And I said, well, maybe they're still taking astronauts. I'm going to be an astronaut. And I remember, he wasn't my husband at the time, he's my husband now, and I remember I said, I'm going to apply to be an astronaut. And he smiled at me. He said, well, good luck. So I called up NASA, and I said, I want to be an astronaut. And I thought they would laugh. I thought they would smile politely. And in fact, they said, well, call this number. Here's an application. You can try this. Now, I didn't submit that application for several years because I really wanted to make it as strong as possible. So I worked on it. And I'll tell you something. I never, ever, ever thought I would actually become an astronaut. Even at that point. But it didn't matter. It was great fun trying. Do you know, I woke up every single morning thinking, wow, what could I do today that will increase my chances of becoming an astronaut? Every single day, for years. It was something I loved. It was my big secret. I didn't think it would work, but it made my life that much more enjoyable trying, going for it. Let's see. You know, when I tell people I flew in space twice, most people say, wow, you flew in space twice. I love this question. You were working as an astronaut for 10 years. How come you only went on two missions? That's a very smart question. You know, I told you I was lucky. I was very lucky because when I started the space program, we were flying the space shuttle missions pretty regularly. And so I flew very quickly. In fact, only 3 years after joining the astronaut program, I flew on my first mission. But between my first mission and my second mission, that's when we began the International Space Station construction. And there were some years when there was only one mission. And something else happened. NASA decided, for budget reasons, to actually eliminate the small spacewalk suit. Now, it turns out most women cannot fit in a medium spacewalk suit. It has to do with the length of the arms and legs because the whole thing inflates. So, I talked about doors opening and closing. There was, certainly the door opened, there could be women astronauts. But in fact, there was a door that shut, and most women did not have a seat any longer because once we started constructing the space station, everybody had to do a spacewalk. And so there were some women that joined the astronaut program just a few years after me. They waited 12 and 13 years before flying their first mission because there just weren't seats for small people who couldn't fit in the larger suit. So I left because it would have been many years before I flew my third mission. And as it turns out, there's a big difference between zero and one mission to space. And there's still a pretty big difference between one and two. Not as big a difference between two and three or three and four. So I was very happy with my two. And life is a journey. Life is a journey. I still don't know what I want to be when I grow up. We'll see. Let's see. Sure. So we're going to get some questions that were written in Arabic, and I don't read Arabic. So I'm getting some help with that.
Well, what is the benefit that you can reap out of being a woman flying into space, a female astronaut? What benefit is that for you?
Well, I will say that when you're an astronaut, when you're in the astronaut program, you do not think of yourself as a female astronaut. People ask me, how many women flew in space? I don't know, and I don't care. There is nothing I've done in my life that I've ever thought that I am a woman skydiver, or I am a woman engineer, or a woman astronaut. And so I always find it a little odd when people talk to me about being a woman whatever. I was an astronaut. And when you're in the program, understand all people care about is, can you do your job? Are you going to be able, people are depending, they have their lives depending on you doing your job. They don't care if you're a woman. They don't care. In skydiving, turns out it is one of the very few sports where strength isn't very important. So there isn't women skydiving and men skydiving. There is just skydiving. The sport of it is that we build formations. You build formations, and it's a wonderful sport. I'm still doing it today. I still compete. It's for 30 years. It's just been an amazing part of my life. But I skydive with men. They don't care whether I'm a woman. All they care about is, will I be where I need to be in order to score that formation so that we can win the competition? So as far as being a female astronaut, there really aren't any other challenges other than the fact that I couldn't fit in that darn medium spacewalk suit.
Right. It turns out that, as you had mentioned earlier, several countries, they send people to space. Is the space travel allowable for each and every country in the world? And what does it actually take for a country to have astronauts flying in space?
That's an excellent question. I think it takes two things. At first, it takes very smart, dedicated scientists and engineers in order to build the spaceships and also to operate very complex missions. I've seen what you are able to build in Egypt. In fact, many thousands of years ago, I've seen what Egyptians were able to build, and it's still happening. So certainly, I think Egypt can do that, and certainly with the initiatives that are going on right now to get more and more young people, both men and women, going into the scientific and engineering fields, I think certainly Egypt has opportunities there. The other thing it takes is a commitment to funding. As you know, even a university like this, to build it, to create it, to operate it, does take funding. And every country is faced with decisions about what is important, what should be funded, what shouldn't be. Every country has the capability. It's just a question of the priority of putting funding towards a human space program versus putting funding towards other things that would help its people. And that's a question that I certainly can't answer, but these are questions, I told you, it's for the generations after us, for you to not only be the ones going to other planets, but those are questions that the young people are going to have to answer for Egypt as well.
Which brings us to a question here. What is the actual cost of space travel? So how much does it cost for a complete trip to space?
That is a very complicated question. How much does it cost to go into space? Because if you think about, if you're a student here or at any university, how much does it cost for you to go to that school? Well, you're sitting in a chair at school and you have your books, and so you could count just those costs. But in fact, that's in a building, and you have to have air conditioning for the building, and you also have to have a place for you to get meals, and you also have to have teachers, and you have to have a great many things around you. So if you add in all of those costs, it could cost many millions of dollars for you to get your education. But, so it depends what you add into that calculation. What I would say is that for NASA, for our human spaceflight program, we spend approximately, depending on how you add it up, 8 to 10 billion US dollars every year on the human space program. How much of it is for any one mission? It's hard to sort that out. It is very expensive. But I will say that more and more countries are committing to this, more and more countries are collaborating, and the more that come together towards this, it will make it cheaper for every new country to join in and have their own astronaut program. In fact, it's only been very recently that China has entered this, and now China has its own astronaut program. That's been very recent. Let's see. Is hibernation in deep sleep pods realistic for long space travel? That's a very good question. Certainly we can make people sleep for long periods of time, and if it's a very long period, they might want to be asleep rather than being bored. I'm not sure it's necessary. The biggest threat to long space travel, say if you're going to Mars or to some other planet, the biggest threat, remember I told you about this magnet that we live on that protects us from dangerous solar radiation? Well, when you're traveling between Earth and another planet or Earth and an asteroid, you will not have that magnetic, that protection. And so, in fact, they do know that the radiation you get will cause cancer. They know it. They don't know how to stop that yet. I tell this story because I told you I was too old to fly anymore. But in fact, one of the ways they're thinking about that they can make that radiation not be a problem is if they fly old people. because the cancer, they know it will happen, but it won't happen for many years. So who knows? Maybe I have a chance yet to go on another mission. Let's see. Ah. What is the truth about the moon landing? How many people do not believe we landed on the moon? You're breaking my heart. You are breaking my heart. We did land on the moon. Yes, that is the truth. I know we did. I did actually fly in space. Is there more to be said? Okay. Okay, this is a statement, not a question. You just made my day. Well, you've just made mine with that. Okay. Are we alone? What is the next step if we are not alone? The universe is huge, vast, ridiculous, ridiculously big. I don't believe for a minute that we are the only, that we are alone, that we are the only form of life in this vast, vast, vast universe. But because it's so big, because it's so far away, I really don't know if we're ever going to meet anybody else in this big, vast universe. Who knows? Who knows how long it will take? Who knows how close or how far away they are? And who knows if they are as intelligent as we are? Who knows? What is the next step? Well, first we have to see if we can talk to them and find them. And there are efforts to try to detect communications from other intelligent life that's out in the universe. I think that's the next step, and we have to wait to see if we find anything. Let's see. What about solar sail? So solar sail is very interesting. You know, I told you about the big bombs, the explosives that we need in order to go into space. So the way we go into space right now is it's like that ball analogy I told you. We throw the ball and then we let it just drift. So if we throw it fast enough, it can drift all the way to Mars or to another planet. Well, there's another way to actually travel. What if you pushed the ball the whole time and you continued to push the ball? It doesn't take as much initial energy, but it would take energy for a very long period of time. And that's really the next step. That's what NASA and that's what countries all over the world are working on, are different types of engines that don't just give you a big boost of energy at the beginning, but find other ways to give you a little bit of energy the whole time. And one of those is with a solar sail. So if you have basically a big sheet that can take in the solar radiation actually has mass, and it can, in the same way that wind can move a felucca across the Nile, which I just did last night, thank you, in that same way you can actually have that solar radiation actually pushing a spacecraft. That's still being developed. We'll see how far it gets. Another thing that they're using is actually, I was talking about ionizing gases. I don't know how many scientists we have here, but in fact, there are ways that you can put an electric field in space, and actually from ions, ionizing gases, you can actually use that to constantly push the spacecraft along. Those are called electric engines, electric propulsion. We'll see if that comes. You know, right now, to go to Mars, it would be a 9-month trip to get there. It would take you 9 months from the time you left to get to Mars. But that's only if you're thrown there. If you have one of these other engines, you could cut that trip down to just a couple of months. Think about that. Think about that. So exciting times ahead. I told you, other doors will open, even those that are closed right now.
First impression visiting Egypt,
And what other research institutions are you visiting or have you visited during this Egypt?
So my first impression of visiting Egypt, you saw what I saw when I went to space. Well, of course, seeing it on the ground is very different. I did take a cruise from Luxor to Aswan before I started speaking about space here in Egypt. And what was so striking to me is that when I saw the Nile and the Delta from space, I thought of it as green grass. And there I was, floating along the Nile and looking over at the palm trees and that are basically living in the desert along the Nile, and it's very, very different. So I think it's very important to understand we can learn a great deal by looking at the Earth from space, but there's nothing that compares to being on the ground. The other thing that I've found since visiting Egypt is just how warm and friendly and kind the Egyptian people have been to me since I've been here. Yes. And I told you before how we look at maps and we look at borders and we think about countries and what is this country doing and that country doing. And then I told you from space we're all earthlings. And I think coming here to Egypt, I realized we are all just earthlings. Warm and friendly, just like the people in my own hometown. So that's been a wonderful part of my visit here. Okay. How do you keep track of time in space? That's an excellent question. So we go around, we have 16 sunrises. I mean, a day doesn't really mean anything. The only thing it means is that we're used to sleeping 8 hours or so a night, and we're used to working. And so we basically set up a mission elapsed time, MET. Everything is based off of an MET. At MET whatever, you will go to bed. At MET whatever, you will wake up. At MET something else, you will do something else. And so it's really just a timer that's clicking down, and it has nothing to do with the sun, the dark, the light. It has nothing to do with that. So that's how we keep track of time and space. I think I've answered some of these. So this is about, is it totally dark in space? What is the view of the sky from space? So when we go into space, we are only hundreds of kilometers off of the planet. You saw just how thin the atmosphere is. We're only slightly above that atmosphere. So we are actually not that much closer to the stars. So the stars don't look any bigger, the planets don't look any bigger, we're not that much closer to them. But what is different is the number of stars that you can see, because all of the light from the cities, that actually makes it impossible to see the dimmer stars. So as I looked out, not just at the Earth, but when I looked out into space, what I saw was many, 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 many more stars. And that goes back to the question is, are we alone? There are just so many stars out there. Another excellent question. How does the ship move about in space? Because thinking of an airplane, you have air that you can push off of, right? If an airplane wants to turn, it banks and it pushes air, and that makes it turn. And if you skydive and you're building formations, you're pushing off of air, and that's how you turn. But in space, there is no air. Well, what we do is we have basically gases that we push out of a port in the shuttle. So again, if I want to move my body from here to there, I push off of it. If I had a big balloon and I let that gas out, I would also move across. And that's basically how the shuttle moves around in space. I told you we slow down 1% when we want to come home. Well, that's what we do. We turn that engine, that little nozzle where the air is going to come out, and we point it in the right direction so that it actually makes us slow down. And that's how we move in space. It's firing these little engines that basically just let out puffs of gas. And then eventually, once we feel enough air, that's when the shuttle stops flying like a rocket ship or a spaceship and starts flying like an aircraft. Did we stop exploring space and have we reached our limits? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. We have only begun. Yes, it takes a long time and it's going to take a long time, but we've only begun. The shuttle is no longer flying, but that's only because the United States is committing funding, dollars, resources, and people to building a new and better set of spaceships so that we can go to places like asteroids or back to the moon or maybe onto Mars. It is just beginning, and you need to be patient. Those doors will open again. Did you go to other planets or did you just go around the Earth? I just went around the Earth. I'll leave the traveling to other planets to you. What is the difference between a shuttle and a rocket? That's another excellent question. The shuttle is just a name. We called it the shuttle because the shuttle is kind of like something that goes back and forth a lot. It's something that's quick. It's something that you can, you know, you might have a shuttle bus to go from here to there. So I think NASA liked the term space shuttle because NASA wanted to go many times, not just once or twice a year, but go many times into space. So they picked the name space shuttle. And in fact, it did. We were doing 8, sometimes more, sometimes 10 missions in a year sometimes. Once we started building the space station, that slowed down only because we were building another spacecraft, and so we didn't need to go as often into space. What is the suit made of? The orange suit is made up of material very similar to this blue suit. This is a material called Nomex, and the big thing about it is it will not catch on fire. This is why astronauts and military people wear these suits, so that if we're in a plane crash, we don't burn up. And likewise, if we're in a space shuttle crash, we won't burn up. It's orange because if we had to get out of our space shuttle, we would have ended up in a life raft in the ocean. And they wanted to make it bright orange because it could be anywhere. If we got a hole in our cabin, we would have re-entered the atmosphere and come home. We could have been anywhere in the world. And NASA would have sent out teams looking all over the ocean for little orange suits everywhere. How long did you stay in space, and does time move faster or slower? On my first mission, we were up for 9 days, and on the second mission, we were up for 10 days. Now, the way physics works is that when you're moving fast, time actually does slow down for you. But this, even as fast as 25 times the speed of sound is, it is not even close to fast enough to make a difference in my age. I wish I could tell you that I came back and I didn't age as much, but really it's just a trivial difference, and I'm just really as old as if I had never gone into space. How do you see the future of private space companies, and will their existence heat up the competition or minimize NASA's role? I think that's a great question. Commercial companies are not doing what they're proposing to do, and what they're working on is not, I mean, NASA is working on vehicles that will get people to Mars. It is a much more complicated vehicle than even these commercial companies are building to go back and forth to the space station. It is a very important part. We need these commercial companies. It's what's going to make going back and forth to the space station more cost-effective, hopefully make it a little bit more safe, especially if we have competition. But NASA's role will always be NASA's role, and in fact, NASA is the one that is funding and giving all the money to these commercial companies. They are not putting in their own money. NASA is paying for these commercial companies to build their own rocket ships. So those companies need NASA, and certainly the American people needs NASA if we want to continue a space program. And you know, NASA is still spends far more money than all the other countries combined in going into space. NASA is very committed to this, and I think the entire world still needs NASA as a partner in going in doing these grand endeavors and going into space. When you come back, do you feel you are the same as when you left? So when you come back, some people are very much affected by being in space. Some people actually go into the hospital, they're in IVs, they can't get back on their feet for days. For me, after 9 days or 10 days, I felt great. I was a little bit dizzy. You know, if you spin around a lot, you know, fast afterwards, you feel a little bit dizzy. For about a minute or so, I felt dizzy, but other than that, I felt great, and I could have run everywhere. Here's a little secret. You may have seen space missions in which the crew would be walking, some of the crew would be walking around the space shuttle, and the announcers would say, well, so-and-so is busy doing scientific experiments. Well, as it turns out, in most cases, they really just weren't feeling up to walking around the shuttle. And so that was code for, yeah, they're not feeling well. I think I'm seeing my bosses stand up. I think I'm getting the cue that we have time for another, maybe one more question. Have you seen the movie Gravity, and are they realistic? So I have not seen Interstellar, but I have seen Gravity, and here's what I would say. The sensation you get from seeing the movie Gravity is absolutely realistic. It is so well done. The feeling of being in space is completely captured by that movie. What's not very realistic is the physics that they're using. So if you suspend belief in physics, then Gravity is very realistic. But in fact, they just got a number of things wrong. So just go there for the experience, and don't go there to learn orbital mechanics or space science. What happens if someone dies in space in the shuttle? So every crew had a medical person that was not, you didn't have a medical background, but NASA would give you a little bit of maybe first aid training, advanced first aid training. But really, NASA is, there wasn't a whole lot of preparation. If somebody died, we would obviously bring the body home, and there would be a call in whether or not we would continue the mission. It would depend exactly on what would happen. It's a very risky business in going into space, and so it's something you think about, but there's really not much in preparation that NASA could do ahead of time other than try to make sure that somebody could help out if somebody got injured or sick, and that's about it. That was about the only preparation. Okay, I like reading your questions, but I can't end this without hearing from one person at least, real life, who is really brave down here so that I can understand, who is really brave enough to stand up and shout out their questions so that I can hear it? Raise your hand. Oh, we've got one gentleman in the back. So the question is about flying in space. Does it make you more or less religious? Does it make you believe more or less in an afterlife? It's a hard question for me to answer because I am a scientist, and so much of going into space is based on science, and I believe in science, and I believe in technology. But by the same, you know, on the same, on the other hand, when you look at the Earth from space, when you look at our universe, it is hard not to believe. It is hard not to believe in a force beyond science. It's very difficult. So I, like most people, I desperately hope there is an afterlife. Desperately hope. And I think on that note, I think we'll come to an end here. Thank you so much. And I just want to tell you all, I'm counting on you, the next generation, to be able to answer questions, the ones that I wasn't able to answer here tonight. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Mary, for the awesome presentation and all the insights that we have about the space and the knowledge and the movie and the experience that we have. I think we are all like now full of energy and enthusiasm to start thinking about education, focus on technology, on the beliefs, and something like that. Actually, we couldn't answer all the questions. We received more than 150 questions, but we tried to make our best to put it available. Now I'm calling Dr. Tariq Khalil to present a gift to Dr. Mary, please.
Dr. Ellen, we are really delighted that you've been with us today. It has been very inspiring. It's a great presentation. I think everybody wants to go to space right now. We thank you. Thank you for contributing to us. Thank you for contributing to our culture, to the message about education. And in small token of our appreciation,
thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor Khalil. Thank you, Dr. Mary. Now I'm calling for a press conference for the next half an hour. It will be held in room F5. So, Dr. Mary, please join us in the stage. Thank you very much. Thank you all, and wish you all have time. And see you again with Nile University. Fantastic thing. Thank you. شكرا لحضراتكم بنتمنى لكم وقت سعيد ومتشكرين ان انتم نورتونا في الجامعه جامعه النيل جامعه كل مصر شكرا